Hi, I'm Connor Quimby, and today I'm going to be discussing if we should be speaking Esperanto. Esperanto is single-handedly the most important and influential non-fantasy calling ever made. In case you're new to my channel or linguistics, let me first define some vocabulary. Feel free to skip to the time on screen, but I would appreciate it if you would stick through it so I get watch hours. A NatLang is a natural language, i.e. languages that have naturally formed over millennia and are what the vast majority of people use as their first language worldwide. Examples include English, Thai, Baguette, Chinese, Swedish, Mayan, Xhosa, and thousands of others. What's very important about NatLangs is that they evolve and morph, sometimes simplifying the language and sometimes complicating things. A conlang is a constructed language of any intention. There are subtypes depending on their form and that set intention. My channel has so far been focused on conlang, or the art of making conlangs. Fantasy conlangs are conlangs specifically made for fantasy storytelling. With the exception of Esperanto, these are the most famous conlangs. In fact, there are more fantasy conlangs on Duolingo than other conlangs. Both Klingon and High Valyrian have Duolingo courses. Other famous fantasy conlangs are Sindaril, Quenya, Dothraki, and Na'vi. An interlang, or altlang, is a conlang which is based off of other natlangs or their families. These are made for either alternate history or for real-world fictional world-building. For example, a Germanic interlang might be either a language that could have developed as something and happened differently in our timeline, or perhaps a new ethnic group's language. Interlangs are meant to fit into the families of natlangs and share similar features. My main conlang, so my actually good one, is Germanic interlang, with the people having broken off from Old Germanic about 400 CE. Interlangs are my favorite type because they feel the most real of the types of conlangs. Brythenig is a good example, created to see what would happen if vernacular Latin evolved in Britain. Logical and philosophical languages are language experiments. Basically, they test linguistic theories or to see if something unheard of before is possible. So, Loglan, Lojban, Wilkins' philosophical language, and Toki-Pona are the main examples. Finally, the last distinct type are Oxlings, or auxiliary languages. They are designed for communication between diverse groups of people. Examples are Ido, Latino Sine Flexione, Sol Re Sol, Volapük, which we'll return to, and arguably the most famous constructed language of all time, Esperanto. Ludwig Zamenhof was a Polish linguist born in the city of Białystok. He was raised bilingual in both Yiddish and Russian, and learned German, Baguette, Hebrew, Polish, Belarusian, Latin, Greek, Aramaic, English, and Volapük. Białystok was extremely ethnically and linguistically diverse, causing many quarrels between the city's population. Zamenhof had a vision that a common language for the people to communicate in would lead to a world with peace and no war. In 1873, he started working on Esperanto, although at the time it had no name. Zamenhof originally published Unua Libro, the first Esperanto book, under the name Dr. Esperanto, meaning one who hopes. In 1904, Fundamento de Esperanto was published and became the only obligatory authority over the language at the first World Esperanto Congress. Zamenhof was very much open to the modification of the language, as he wanted to evolve to suit the people even better. He also did this to make sure that Esperanto did not suffer the same fate as Volapük. Volapük was the main auxling before Esperanto, and was massively popular, having multiple worldwide conferences held only in Volapük. However, the creator could not take constructive criticism to fix the language, and the community fractured. It was at this point Esperanto was widely discovered, and thus the language had its biggest growth in the early 20th century. At the beginning of the League of Nations, Esperanto was considered for being the official language of the League, and was given official status by the UN later in 1954. There were even plans to make neutral Moresnet, a small condominium/country between Belgium and the German Empire in the early 20th century, the first Esperanto state, although this was defeated. Today, there are around 2 million speakers of the auxling, most in Europe and East Asia, and there are even over 1,000 native speakers. Even crazier, there are a few second-generation native speakers. There are books, websites, massive amounts of Wikipedia articles, poems, songs, and so much more in Esperanto. The question is, why don't we use it? The goal of Zamenhof was to create a language easy for everyone to learn, and to bring communication and peace to the world. Before we get into the linguistics of why, Esperanto lost a large amount of its community in the mid-20th century due to targeting by Nazi Germany, as they feared the Jewish roots of the language, and Soviet Russia, even though for the first 20 years of the Union it was actually encouraged by the state and even studied by Stalin. This large loss in speakers hurt the expansion of the language, and with the fact that the Americans want nothing to do with it, many just think it's from the Spanish city of Esperanza, it has slowed down over the years. But now with the internet, the question has come to mind. Should we be speaking Esperanto? Should we enact the goals and dreams of Dr. Esperanto, the one who hopes? The main arguments for Esperanto stem from Zamenhof's original goals: to increase world communication, foster peace, and bring humanity closer together. We see this in the Esperanto community today, as many of the native speakers' parents only have Esperanto in common, or in the travel and world conferences where Esperantists use Esperanto. There are institutions in Europe and China directed in Esperanto, and there has been an increase in the usage of the language in South America, notably Brazil, recently. As well, Esperanto has been considered to be the lingua franca of the European Union, as using English costs billions and really only benefits the British, which, looking at the current political situation, do you really need to use English anymore? If more people started learning Esperanto, a relatively easy language to learn as a second language rather than English or baguette, two of the main lingua francas today, we could communicate more efficiently around the world and hopefully increase peace as it pertains to Zamenhof's goals. On the other side of the argument comes in the many flaws of Esperanto. Being created for Europeans to learn, it draws most of its vocabulary and grammar from Indo-European languages, especially the Romance languages, German and Russian. This makes it very hard for speakers of East Asian languages to learn, essentially as if they were learning English. Essentially, if Esperanto was more widely learned, it would be dominated by Europeans and essentially be an auxiliary for Europe. There's also the fact that languages evolve over time. While Zamenhof established the official authority, Fundamento de Esperanto, and essentially acted as the head of the language during his life, after his death, what to do with modification was left up to the community. The World Esperanto Congress has since only added 9 additions to the language since the Fundamento de Libro, mostly dealing with new vocabulary. The problem of this comes in with more speakers. If the number of speakers continually rises, then there are inevitably going to be dialects that emerge and variations to the core language. The Congress has to decide if they crack down on that shift and risk the fate of volapuke, continually change the language, which would take mass amounts of resources to distribute and not everyone would update their knowledge of the language, or allow Esperanto to gradually split into mutually intelligible languages based off the speaker's native language, until Esperanto has both the classical and vulgar forms, similar to the fate of Latin. European forms would emerge, Chinese forms would emerge, etc. Then there's the problem of Esperanto potentially hurting linguistic diversity by causing speakers to abandon their native tongue in favor of a lingua franca, which over generations could almost wipe out even stronger languages like Hungarian, although something like that happening is very unlikely. Finally, Zamenhof must have watched How to Make an Awful Conlang, because there are a bunch of problems with Esperanto that make it annoying. If Esperanto was meant to be an interlang, this would be normal, but because it's an auxlang, he made mistakes by copying grammar and sounds directly from other languages. Words were copied again, which would be fine if Esperanto was an interlang, and it can also be very hard to learn if the learner's East Asian per se. Also, the orthography has some major flaws. There are 5 letters using the circumflex pronounced ch, zh, h, zh, sh, and one with the brave pronounced w or w. These are hard to use in the computing system, as they are either unsupported or just don't easily exist on the keyboard use. Zamenhof proposed using an h after the base consonant, but computers can't distinguish between if the h is pronounced or not. Recently, using X after the consonant was proposed and is a shortcut on Duolingo, but, ugh, use X for a sound, please. I honestly can't answer the question if we should be speaking Esperanto or not. On one hand, it would be a much better lingua franca than the ones used today, because English is, as the baguettes say, merde, and the history and goals of the language are just beautiful. However, having a worldwide auxlang used by vastly different cultures on the scale of the question of this video would immediately start to fracture the language or cause strife in the community. The language is much harder for non-Indo-European speakers to learn, and there are a large amount of problems with the language's grammar and orthography. Conclude, Esperanto estas fascina temo, kaj mi pensas, ke mi eble iom studos ĝin. Ĝis tiam, mi estas Conor Quimby, kaj ĉi tio estis Ĉu ni parolu Esperanto. Adiaŭ, kaj dankon pro spektado! Se vi ŝatis ĉi tiun filmeton, bonvolu ŝati kaj aboni. Vi ankaŭ povas subteni min ĉe Patreon por ekskluzivaj rekompensoj. Dankon.